How long have you lived in Kansas City?
I've lived in Kansas City since 1920.
You moved here from...
St. Joseph, Missouri.
That's where you were born and raised?
Born in Highland, Donovan County, Kansas.
Okay. And you moved to St. Joseph from there?
Yes. After I finished high school in Highland, Kansas, I came to St. Joseph and went to work for Dr. W.J. McGill.
What kind of work did you do?
I was a chauffeur for Dr. W.J. McGill.
Mm-hmm. And what about your parents? What did your parents do?
My parents? My father was a horse and mule buyer.
Mm-hmm. In Kansas.
Yes, I want to go back a little further. My grandfather bought his way out of slavery.
Mm-hmm.
So he had worked for old lady Polly Sweeney.
In Bath
County, Kentucky.
Mm-hmm.
Slave buyers came by to want to buy my grandfather, and she said she didn't raise niggers to sell.
Mm-hmm.
And she gave my grandfather an opportunity after he got through his work on the plantation, to cut the bluegrass seed, go out in the field and cut and shock corn.
Mm-hmm.
And cut cordwood. And she saved up pretty close to $1,000. Because she had been offered $1,600 for him. That was a going price of a slave.
Mm-hmm.
And but before he had a chance to buy his way out of slavery, the war ceased, and she gave him that money to my grandfather.
Hmm.
He got him a team.
That was a pretty good stake in those days. Huh?
And he helped and some other slaves whom he freed, built the first schoolhouse in Bath County, Kentucky, for Negroes to go to school.
Hmm. And then did he move eventually to Kansas? Or
I'm talking about my grandfather.
Right.
And on my grandfather and Will Sweeney, his son, my father's name was Robert, the son of mine. He came to from Kentucky to Highland, Donovan County, Kansas, and worked for a man by the name Robert L. Stone.
Mm-hmm.
And Stone and Williams were in the horse and mule business and gave my father an opportunity to work around.
Mm-hmm.
And where they knew that he had mule sense, they had a place down here in Missouri where they kept a group of mules.
Mm-hmm.
And they got out of that, and there were 100 and some of them got up, and they had drowned them all up and gotten them all back, and so my father said, "You've gotten them all back except one gray mare mule," and said, "Anybody's got that kind of sense, we're going to give you a chance to buy it." Possibly, that's what you got in from the part.
Uh-huh. And then you moved, how old were you when you moved to St. Joseph?
I had finished high school, 17 years old.
Uh-huh. And what year was that?
I finished high school 1912.
What year were you born?
I was born November 14th, 1895.
Okay. And how long were you in St. Joseph?
I worked for Dr. W. McGill 7 years. I went to the Army from Dr. Mm-hmm. McGill's home.
You were driving an automobile, or was that
I was driving an automobile.
How did you learn to drive?
Well, I learned to drive a Ford car in the Highland, Kansas.
Uh-huh. Model T.
Model T Ford.
Uh-huh. Just out of curiosity, what kind of car did the doctor have?
He had a 1912 Cadillac.
That's quite a car in those days.
Mm-hmm.
And then what year, or how did you go about this, getting into the service, and what year did you enter?
After the war had been going on for some time, there were about 25 persons who went to the Army under Homer Roberts. He got a group of men together. Mm-hmm. Bill Knox was one of the men who was in that group. Mm-hmm. And he picked... Bill knows about a man. I'll say from 18 to 20 men. Mm-hmm. Top Negro men that were chauffeurs in the post office or other place. Mm-hmm. And they went into the Signal Corps under Homer, Lieutenant Homer Wright. Mm-hmm.
They formed
a group, and he took them to Camp Function, Kansas. Mm-hmm. And that's where Homer Roberts got his commission. And some of them went into the ambulance company, and some went into to Field Hospital. Mm-hmm. I went into 317th Sanitary. I was in 317th Sanitary Train, and in one of the field hospital companies. Mm-hmm. And I didn't go with this group because of Homer Roberts. Mm-hmm. I went at a later date.
Mm-hmm. What date did you actually go into service?
I'm trying to think of the date that I went into service. I'm not so sure about I think it was April of this. I think Bill was wrong about the time that we chipped out. Mm-hmm. Because I think I went in the April of the 17th, 1918. Mm-hmm. I went from Dr. W. McGill's house. Mm-hmm.
And do you also train at Princeton?
Yes, I went up later than Bill. Mm-hmm. His group went up. Yeah. And I went up there and I was around the headquarters company there. Mm-hmm. About 4 or 5 days, and I was soldiering with Bill's and them companies. Mm-hmm. Going out on hikes and things with them. Mm-hmm. And then Colonel David B. Downing wanted to send me home. Hmm. And because, I hadn't joined the Army yet. I was just one of them. They were physicians and surgeons. Mm-hmm. That was one of the requisites for them to be an officer in the sanitary train or in the ambulance company. Mm-hmm. And we took training before we went to the front. Mm-hmm. We had to learn about a compound fracture, compound comminuted fracture.
Even as an ambulance driver.
In a field hospital too. Mm-hmm. Because one field hospital man is worth 18 men on the front, because you can save the man.
Sure.
We had to learn how to use tetanus, how to inject a man, mm-hmm. how to make a tourniquet to keep a man from bleeding. So we had
emergency
some training.
Procedures.
We had some training in the medical field, because all of our officers were doctors. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a very important part about that, because naturally, of course, they had to be doctors to be in the ambulance company or in the field hospital. And the ambulance company in the field hospital was to... the field hospital was what it is. It was a field hospital. And the ambulance company evacuated the men back to the field hospital.
Did that field hospital, was that moved around as...
As we led from front to front. Mm-hmm. Everything in the 92nd Division, in any division, is mobile.
Was the hospital usually set up in a permanent building, like did they use an old church or something, or was there any tents?
Well, they had to improvise, whatever.
Buried?
Yes, right. Mm-hmm.
And then you went... You shipped over to France on the same ship as...
I shipped over to France. And I believe that we went over in... I believe we shipped out up in France in June of 1918. Mm-hmm. On the northern Pacific. Mm-hmm. two ships from the Pacific Ocean. They sailed side by side, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And we went over in 7 days.
From New York?
We went over in 7 days in New York.
And was that a convoy?
No, we had a convoy at first, but after the about a day out of New York, we were by on our own.
Hmm.
Our ships were two very fast ships crossed over there at that time,
mm-hmm.
when the Atlantic Ocean was infested with submarines, but we crossed in 7 days.
Hmm. Did you have any signs of submarines or any warning danger?
Yes, we had warning, because I remember the fellows who were on the command of the gun,
mm-hmm.
They were singing, "I wish Mr. Submarine would show up his head." But then those guns were turned loose. They thought they saw a submarine.
Mm-hmm.
But we had two very fast ships.
So they didn't bother going to slow convoys?
We didn't go in a slow convoy.
Did you, do you know if you zigzagged and, changed course as they often?
Well, I don't know how the pilot went, because I couldn't tell what was it, but we had the man in our crow's nest. He never left that crow's nest from the time that he left the port in New York City.
Did you have to wear your life jackets throughout the voyage?
No.
Did you have any lifeboat drills on board?
Yes, we had lifeboat drills. We had a good time going over, and we had quite a time going over there. I am, of course, Bill. He was a gambler, and I was trying to make me some money.
Did you?
And I remember they issued us some oranges and things like that,
uh-huh.
and I got her. Bought up those oranges, sold them later on to the some of the boys with gambling. Then I got in with the I got in with the chef, but I always can make me some money on that ship.
Do you know how many soldiers were on the ship about?
Well, on the I don't know how many soldiers are, but on our ship, the four hospital companies, the ambulance companies, the headquarters company, and what other companies were on there, a soldier wouldn't know.
Mm-hmm.
But our ship was loaded.
It
was a large ship.
Was your equipment on there too, or did that come over in another ship? Or?
I am quite sure that our equipment was loaded on there.
Was it all black soldiers, or was it?
Was all black soldiers. 92nd Division made up of 33,300 men.
Mm-hmm.
The 92nd Division, when it was organized, some of the officers I'm speaking about.
Mm-hmm.
Colonel Young should have been the general of the 92nd Division.
Mm-hmm.
But at that time, prejudice was so widespread and so deep, notwithstanding the fact that Colonel Young had ridden a horse from his home to Washington, D.C. They wouldn't let him be general of the 92nd Division.
He was a colonel.
Yeah, he was one of the first Negroes who graduated West Point.
Mm-hmm.
Colonel Young.
Mm-hmm.
And another thing, beautiful thing about the 92nd Division. Man become an officer in that our outfit, he had to be a medical man.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a training company, that was one of the first training corps set up in Negroes. It was in Des Moines, Iowa.
Yeah.
And officers training camp was set up there, but young Negro doctors who went to go to the Army went up to Des Moines to get their training. And another good thing about our division was that our division was made out of a very high caliber tanker in that division. Mm-hmm. Notwithstanding the fact that it was made up of former soldiers of the 9th and 10th Cavalry in the 24th and 25th. And
professional soldiers.
Professional soldiers. Professional soldiers. Professional soldiers. We had men in our outfit up to the rank of major. Major Dean was the only Negro major. He was in the divisional headquarters. Mm-hmm. You asked Mr. Knox a very interesting question about what was our feeling when we got to France. When French people welcomed up with open arms. That is the only time that I ever knew and realized what a real American soldier was. The French people had no prejudice whatever. Negro soldiers fraternized with the French girls, just like the white soldiers do. Mm-hmm. The only time we had some troubles when the Wildcat Division from the south came, trying to think of what camp we were. We were around La Rochelle.
Yeah, 81st Division.
I think a little town named La Rochelle. Mm-hmm. And we had some trouble with those white boys from the south. Mm-hmm. And we had a man named Dynamite Brown. Dynamite Brown. Well, he called all those soldiers together. And we almost had some trouble over there, but somebody came over from the division headquarters and quieted it down. But that was the only time that we ever had any trouble with the white soldiers.
What was your job when you were in France? What did you do specifically?
I was assigned to headquarters company, 317th Sanitary Train. I kept the records, and now each one of the four hospital companies, the ambulance companies, mm-hmm. and the other people in the hospital in Sanitary Train had to send their ration report, mm-hmm. and would figure up the subsistence and rations that they needed, and that was my duty in the supply department.
In
the
paperwork.
Mm-hmm.
How often did you move as a unit?
Well, that depended upon what just what how the war was going. Mm-hmm. We moved several times, but we didn't. The last time we moved was in September in 1982. That's when we moved up to the moved up to the Argonne Force. Up to Townville, remember, Saint-Minihoe. And that was before the final drive that broke this war wide open.
Before you went into the Argonne, Battle of the Meuse-Argonne, I believe your unit went in with the French division, didn't it? And relieved them.
We went in with all the divisions, the French and American divisions, and all of them massed up on that front.
Do you remember seeing a lot of French troops in your area?
Yeah, the French troops, that's where we came in contact with the Negro. France had a lot of Negro officers, mm-hmm. but I'll say this about those French Negro officers. They didn't have too much to do with American Negro. Mm-hmm. They felt themselves superior to us, and I guess they had a right to be, because the French people gave them that type of feeling, because they were officers, and they were I don't know what the ranks were, but they were into their outfits.
Did any of your comrades or yourself, did you speak French?
Well,
did you learn French while you were over there?
I learned a little French myself, yes. And I can converse with mademoiselles quite. I could get along very nicely with them. And that was the only time that I ever felt like that was a full-fledged American citizen, because they treated the black soldiers just like they treated the white soldiers. No difference whatever. France is a wonderful country. And they certainly would treat the Negro soldier. They had a great respect and admiration for him.
When the Argonne battle began, did you have a feeling that that was going to be the last battle of the war? Did you have the feeling that the Germans were about ready to surrender?
I thought when the I'm talking about that 72-hour barrage. Mm-hmm. When that 72-hour barrage had, it looked to me like that was going to be the end of the world. That is a time that I had never seen as many airplanes. The air was just black with airplanes going on over the boom, the Germans. And I can see how they didn't, Germans couldn't stand, because it was just a terrific bombardment. And that's when the Germans gave up. Bill and I both were in that 72-hour barrage.
What were your impressions of the battlefield there, no man's land? The trenches.
When we went up to the. Now you've heard about the Argonne Fort. It's a thicket. It is a fort. We occupied a place where the Germans, made beds and trees and things. It's a thicket fort. The Argonne Fort is really a fort. I never seen anything like it in my life.
Did you ever go down in any of those German dugouts?
Yeah, the trenches, where the German trenches that had, where they'd been living there. Some of them had, down in the trenches there, they had pianos where they'd been living there for a long time. They thought they were dug in.
Did you notice any of those miniature railroad, the small gauge railroad tracks?
I didn't come in contact with any of those. But it was, I should never forget my feeling, because when a person says that fear doesn't leave you, but when that time comes and you know that this is it, that is what if you get knocked off, it's just all right. If not, it's all right. But you made up your mind that's either you're going to be victorious or you're going to, that's going to be the end of
it. Mr. Knox mentioned that he, in action, his ambulance was damaged by shell fire, knocked off a plate off the ambulance. Do you remember, were you actually under fire yourself?
I wouldn't know anything about it. See, his, Bill's company is altogether different from my company. See, I served all of my time in the headquarters
company. Did the headquarters company ever, on special occasions, ever get into the forward lines?
Well, what we did, we got to move up with the line, see what I mean? Because we got the supply, but we keep a certain distance from them, because we've got to supply the men.
Do you remember, do you see columns of German prisoners coming back from the front?
Yes, I've seen some German soldiers coming back from the front.
How were they treated by the American soldiers?
They were treated all right. You see, when a German soldier gives up, then you become comrade. You see, that's when you become that's when he calls you comrade, and he's very meek and submissive, because. I think that's where that term comrade originally the German soldier, because that's when it becomes a comrade. Too.
Was there a feeling at that time, was there a hatred of the German himself, or was it Was it that they were the enemy and you had to fight them? For the individual, was there any hatred that you could
I remember one time when we were in training. I mean, in other words, you got to have some training before you go up to the line. I remember, I'm trying to think of that town in France, Belmay, I remember it. The German soldiers would come down and use a place to wash their clothes one time, and the next time the American soldiers would come down. And then when that was what you call a quiet front. And then some American soldiers came up there and upset the apple cart and opened up on those German soldiers. And there wasn't any bitter feelings, but because I remember that time. Bill, I think you remember that time too, because the German soldiers would come down and wash their clothes one time and American soldiers another time. Wouldn't bother anyone. That's what you call a quiet front.
I had often heard that the 92nd Division was a feared division. The Germans feared the men.
Well,
because they were black soldiers.
They were. That's right. And when they shot at them, they said that they'd never come in contact with the Negro soldiers. Said they turned black and just keep on coming because. We had an outfit out of New York, I think the 372nd, the Rattlesnake Division. The Rattlesnake Division was a very fine group of soldiers.
With this insignia here, that wore the Rattlesnake.
The Rattlesnake, yes, Rattlesnake Division. They were out in New York, and they were made up too of former soldiers. Trying to think of the man who led them, and they had a band and everything, but they established themselves over there as quite a group of them.
Before the armistice was signed, do you remember seeing any famous people like General Pershing or any of the French commanders?
No, because you take General Pershing and the French commanders, they stayed back in the headquarters, away from the front. Of course, Patton wasn't I think he was in World War II. But a soldier like Patton, you like the soldier and a man who's fearless. Now we had one man in our outfit named Dynamite. A man of the 24th Infantry, but it could inspire men like
he was one of your officers.
Yes, but men like to you like to follow an officer of that caliber, and he inspires men. And you like a soldier under that man. I would have liked a soldier under Patton because he's my type of soldier. He was a leader.
Armistice Day. One of the things I was interested in. Did it come as a surprise, or has there been rumors that the armistice is going to be signed? Or
well, you may have what you call that scuttlebutt, but I don't think it got to us that armistice was going to. It came as a surprise to
what? What do you recall?
Yes, we were right in the midst of it when the armistice came, but that was a great day. That's when there's a great celebration of the Empire.
Was that part of the agreement that both sides pulled back or something? Or did they remain their positions on the Germans agreed?
At that point,
yeah.
When the armistice it happened at 11 o'clock that morning, do you recall the guns stopping, the cannon
well,
stopping?
Well, there was a the news didn't get to all at the same time. Mm-hmm. See, but there was a gradually a lull and. we realized that that was it.
Did you move into the Army of Occupation, or did you stay in France and participate in cleaning up
no,
the battlefields?
No, 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 no. Another outfit that the pioneer infantry came in there.
What happened immediately following the armistice that you remember, as far as what actions did your unit take? Did you pull back?
We pulled back. And I'm trying to think of a town where we went to when we pulled back from the front. When we pulled back from the front.
To Le Mans?
It wasn't an answer.
To Le Mans?
We pulled back to a little town. And that was the time, Bill, that we had an opportunity to visit Nancy in southern France, because after we'd been on the front, we had a chance to visit some of the places in France.
Do you remember when you were issued your steel helmets and gas masks?
Yes, we were issued those in training. That's what we trained. We had to train for gas masks.
Did you get them after you'd arrived in France or before you left?
I think we were learning how to use the gas mask before we got in France.
What was it like to wear a World War I gas mask?
Well, you had to learn how to breathe in with it and how to live with it. But it's after you learn it, it's a very simple thing. It's a matter of survival.
Did you ever come under gas attack?
I never did have to really get. I don't know whether I ever got in. I don't think I ever got in. Yeah, I don't. I was kind of headquarters company. See, I'm, headquarters company is a little bit just a little bit different from the up there.
Do you recall your division being called the Buffalo Troops, the Buffalo Soldiers at that time?
Oh, yes. We were the 92nd Division.
But do you remember a nickname being applied?
The Buffalo, yes. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. And that was...
We were very proud. We were very proud of the 92nd Division, because the 92nd Division was one of the first Negro divisions that was ever activated in the United States Army. And we were proud of the Buffalo Division. It was a great division. It was made up of... even in the machine gun company, it was made up of a very high caliber type of an individual. I remember in the 317th, I think 317th machine gun company, the tech dealer who was a school teacher at Lincoln High School here, he was in one of the machine gun companies. And in the, company, Stronger we kept communication with the field outpost company. We were a very high class of men that made up the 92nd Division. High caliber.
Do you remember there were a lot of other Negro troops in France that were not allowed to serve together as a division? They were men that ultimately became the 93rd Division, and they served with the French and they wore French equipment. Mm-hmm. And so did you ever remember seeing those?
Never came in contact with them at all. Never came in contact with the 93rd Division. I just never did come in contact. Didn't know anything about them.
Did you have a chance to dream, while you were in France or during the war, to go on either pass or leave?
Yes.
You mentioned going to Nancy.
After we were in there for 6 months in the headquarters company when Nordic comes through, we got a chance to go to Nancy one place. That order came through and I took advantage of it. And I went to Nancy in southern France. And I lived with like a king there for a few days. We had a big time. That's one of the greatest times. Bill, I don't think you got to make that trip, but I went to Nancy down in southern France. And that's built a place, and where we had we lived in a hotel. Mm-hmm. And we had I was with a bunch of fellows who had plenty of money, and we I remember one time we were trying to get a room in a hotel, and the fellow said the hotel. So we took out a 100-franc note. He found us some room. So, but of course, money, you know, in other words, when you go on a trip like that, you got so much money, you got so much money to spend, and you're going to spend it because you don't know whether this is the last time you're going to make a trip or not, see? So you just have a big time.
Did your unit have a band?
Oh, my Lord, yes.
What time did they play pretty good music?
They played fine music, they do fine music. That's one of the greatest, one of the most beautiful sights that anybody has ever seen. As when you call, I believe it's called guard money. That's when all the units, the field hospital, the ambulance companies, machine gun companies, the infantry companies, certain amount of that of the 92nd Division, all assembled upon at one place and passing review. That's one of the most beautiful signs, to see that American flag get unfurled over there and see those soldiers at that time. That's one of the most impressive things that I remember out of the Army. And it makes you proud that you are an American citizen, makes you proud that you're the forces with which you are serving. And notwithstanding the fact of all of the injustices associated with it, being denied the opportunity of, even when being denied the opportunity of being in a Jim Crow car, letting the German soldiers eat before we do, still yet America is a great country. And I felt, even at that time, after war was over, if war would break out again, I would volunteer and go back and fight this country.
Do you feel that the experience of the American Negro in World War I, do you think that that had a beneficial effect on the ultimately receiving more rights as citizens here back home? Do you think the American people appreciated what the Negro soldiers did in World War I?
I don't think so at that particular time, because I remember the time that after Negro soldiers had been discharged out of the Army, some people didn't want him to wear that American uniform. They were treated badly all through the South. Even the adjutant general and the people who controlled the 92nd Division, and when I'm discharged, instead of discharging me out of headquarters of 317th Sanitary Train, they discharged me out of some kind of a late battalion. That shows on my discharge now. In other words, the American white man did everything, in other words, to try to play you down and degrade you and not let you think that you had been over there to fight to make the world safe for democracy. He wanted to put you in your place. And that comes from Washington all the way down. In other words, he's always tried to make me think that I have a certain place as a citizen. That has never bothered me because I didn't let it bother me. Notwithstanding the fact that I knew that I was I've been able to circumvent myself because I've gotten along pretty well. But some other persons haven't done as well as I have done, see. But that is the attitude of the American white man toward the American Negro. And that condition probably prevails somewhat today.
You mentioned you were active in the American Legion. Was that an all-black chapter?
Yes. Homer Roberts organized the Wayne Minor Post in 149. I was a charter member of it. Later became a commander of it. I later organized the 269 Tactical Post of the Veterans Foreign War. I became commander there. I became the department vice commander of the Veteran Foreign War. Also became department vice commander of the American Legion. So I've been very active in the Legion. I remember a time when we went to the, after we'd been back here in the States, we were 1928, we went to North Louisiana to a national convention. And I remember that I was marching in the Army. I marched down south there with the, and the white citizens, some of the white citizens said, "What's that Negro doing, you know, in the marching in that army?" And I remember I was with a group out of St. Louis, and those white boys took up for me and said I had as much right in there as anybody else. But I have lived all through that. I remember the St. Charles Hotel in New Orleans, Louisiana, where Negroes couldn't go into the front door of that hotel.
That's where the convention was?
That's where the convention was. That didn't only prevail in Louisiana, that prevailed right here in Kansas, Missouri. I can remember when Negroes couldn't go in the front door in the Mubach Hotel. I can remember when Negroes couldn't stay in a hotel. You couldn't stay in any hotel. I remember after I came back to the Army, when Negroes couldn't eat in any public eating place. I've lived all through that area.
If you had if you were able to just sit down and talk to all the young people that you know that are growing up these days and don't remember World War One, is there anything that you'd like to impart to them, to tell them, you know, about your experiences in World War One and what they should probably know about the role of the American Negro in World War One?
I think they should. I think they should know it. Yes, I think they should know it. And in addition to that, I think they should know it and know the our conditions what exists at that time. We should tell it to them. They should be cognizant of the fact of the we've come a mighty long way. I think the school should be, first I think history should be rewritten, then I think Negro history should be taught, that should be a course in the school. I think they should give some of the better things of what the Negro has done. I think they should go on back to the time the Negroes brought up here in 1620, and they ought to bring them on down to the Negroes' part that they played in the Revolutionary War. I think they ought to play the part the Negro served, as a slave, and then the part he played in the Civil War, because the tide didn't turn in the Civil War until the Negro slave was freed and the Negro soldiers joined the Union Army. I think that the history should be rewritten about the part the Negro played in the Reconstruction area. I think it should be emphasized when we had 28 Negro senators and congressmen in the United States House of Representatives and the Senate. I think it should we should show whether it was Negro was elected to the United States Senate from Louisiana named, he was Lieutenant Governor of Louisiana, and the a senator from Louisiana wouldn't, before you can be seated, the present senator has to take you up and present you to the Senate. But he never took him up and present him, and he never was seated as a United States Senator. I understand the fact he had served as Lieutenant Governor of Louisiana and was elected as United States Senator. I think history should show when the Negro was in the Reconstruction era that every Negro was in the Reconstruction era that was elected as a representative was not a Negro. We had some Negroes in the during the Reconstruction era who had their PhD degree. In other words, the slave master had sent them to the University, McGill University in Canada, and also in this in England. We had one Negro in Cardozo, I think, in South Carolina, a very learned man. And not only that, but history hadn't shown it. History hadn't shown what the Negro has done, or the what the legislation that was passed during the Reconstruction era. I think that the educational system which we have here in America, I think it was advanced in all the states by some of the legislation what the Negroes passed during the Reconstruction era. So I think history should be rewritten, but let the Negro youth know about
World War I specifically. Though you feel that the true story of the participation of the Negro should be told.
It should be told, and it should be taught. Just like you here, you don't have anything in here, but no Negro. I remember when this place was dedicated, but no Negro participated in the dedication of this building. Wasn't on the program when you dedicated this building. I don't have any history of any Negroes here at all. I don't think.
From our records, I understand that in the fundraising, raising the money for the memorial, that the black Kansas Cityans did have a very active part. They raised money to build this memorial.
That's quite true, but we didn't participate in the ceremony. I think I gave some money for this little boy. I believe I did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, do you? I wanted to ask if you recalled the 10-day campaign in 1919, when they tried to raise the money. Do you have any recollections of that?
Yes, I remember it because the American Legion was in we were in this thing. Mm-hmm. And we participated in it. The American Legion did, but we took a very active part in it. And
Do you remember the parade, for instance, that they had?
I was in it.
Did you march in the parade?
I was in it. I mean, when they were this building. And when, because I came up here with a very good friend of mine who later became a recorder of deeds in Washington, Dr. William J. Tompkins. We were here at this dedication. Mm-hmm.
And that was in 1921.
Yeah. I was going to ask you, did the 92nd Division, did you have many medals or citations awarded?
I did have some things, but I still have, I think, in my possession, two of those brass 75 shells
casings.
And some people had them made into an armored base, mm-hmm. but I think I still have two of those 75.
You didn't lose them.
I still have them. I brought them back from the army.
Oh, where were you mustered out? What?
I was mustered out right out here. I was brought back right here to the Fairfax Academy. Mm-hmm. Mustered out.
And then
I came on back to.
By train.
I came back to Kansas City, Missouri, and when I was mustered out of the Army, I came back to St. Louis, Missouri, to Dr. McGill's house. Mm-hmm. Mrs. McGill put me in the guest room, and I was a guest of the people for whom I had worked.
Mm-hmm. What have you done in the years since, just briefly, what occupation and professionally?
I started back to work for Dr. McGill in St. Joseph. Then I came to Kansas City, Missouri, and I did various things, hop bells and things like that to settle down. And then I, in 1900, and I worked various jobs in 1923. I went to work for Mr. A.R. Jones, a multi-millionaire oil man, and I worked for A.R. Jones from 23 to 26, and then I took the examination. I went to the post office department. I went in Verizon Drive, I went in as a non-certified sub in 1926 in the Railway Mail Service, and I worked as a non-certified sub for 3 years. In other words, when I saw that the mail was getting slim, I took old man Fair by the hand and took him over to the terminal and told him if the inspectors came in there and found that place as dirty as it was, They wouldn't only fire me, but they'd fire everybody in the front office. So they gave me an opportunity to gave me a group of men to clean up the terminal. And after I had cleaned up the terminal, they gave me a job as a janitor up at the annex. I took every examination that came up. I made 101 and 51-100 as a guardsman driver. And I worked as a guardsman driver until 1936. In 1936, Jim Farley was a postmaster general, and he said anybody that you can take a non-competitive examination. I took a non-competitive examination and passed, and came over as a clerk carrier. I served for 3 years as a clerk carrier, and up to 1900. I served 3 years as a clerk carrier, and then I was appointed as a regular. And then Mr. Truman was running for president in 1948, and I was active, notwithstanding the fact that the Hatch Act, we raised money from Mr. Truman and the group that I was with. We were the only group that saw Mr. Truman after he had spoken in Des Moines, Iowa. And Secretary Icke sent Miss Ann Hedgman out here from Washington, D.C. to campaign for Truman. Ann Hedgman stopped at my home, and we raised some money for Truman. We gave it to Tom Evans and sent it to Truman. Truman was elected as president in November 1948, and appointed me as the first Negro supervisor, December 8, 1948, of the Kansas, Missouri Post Office. I worked as a supervisor until I was retired July the 1st, 1964, and from that time I have been taking very little and living a fine life.
I wish to ask Mr. Morris what he's been doing.
Tell me about your experience in Hearns.
Oh, yeah. Hearns, Governor Warren Hearns was from down here to Charleston, Missouri, in the Coot Hill, where he wasn't very accustomed to the Negroes. And I got acquainted with Hearns when he was the representative in the Missouri General Assembly. And I brought him up here in 1959 to speak for Miss Roberta Aikens. She had graduated from the beauty school. Hearns didn't know very much about Negroes at that time, but I by the time I got through with him, he had learned about Negroes, and I knew him when he was Secretary of State. I was representing the Secretary of State. He drove from St. Louis to come up here to speak to the Broken Milk Club. I got him on as the speaker of the Broken Milk Club. We used to have a wild game dinner. And I introduced Hearns there, and we got a little bit better acquainted with the Negroes. Then we got him, when he came up for to be elected for governor, we got him elected as governor. He appointed me as a colonel on his staff. And on his first time, and then on his second term, I've served as a colonel on Hearns' staff. Another thing, Mr. Hasty used to be down the bridge down in he belonged to that Truman $500 membership. Mm-hmm. I have a $500 membership in the Truman Library. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if there's any other Negro that, but I felt that that was the least thing that I could do for Mr. Truman, because he had, there's one thing about Harry S. Truman. if you're with him, he never forgot him as friends, because when he was elected in November as president, and then he appointed me as the first Negro supervisor. And I want to tell you another thing about Mr. Truman as a president. He broke down segregation in the Kansas City, Missouri post office, because when I was appointed as a supervisor, I was the first Negro supervisor in Kansas City, Missouri post office. We had two or three Negro clerks at that time, Muldrew and Gardner. And that was a breaking down of it, because I remember at that time they used to have the Negro carriers to come in from out the country club station, various other stations, and help work the mail down those clerks at night. And some of those white clerks, Mr. Graham was postmaster. They objected to those Negro carriers coming down there and working as clerks. So Mr. Graham called them all in his office one day and said, "Now, our postmaster of this Kansas, Missouri post office, and any of you white people who don't want to serve with these Negro carriers who are coming down here working as clerks, I'm ready to accept your resignation." So they all tipped out of there, quieter than a mouse walking on cotton. And we didn't hear anything from that night. So Harry S. Truman, mm-hmm. I have written a 44-page history on Mr. Truman, and that's in the Truman Library down there now, because Truman, in my opinion, he followed the steps of Roosevelt. What he did more about breaking down segregation here in Kansas City, Missouri, than any other person that's ever been here in Kansas City, Missouri. Another man I think we shouldn't forget about in this part of the country is Joe Shannon, because I'm talking about now in the early 1900s. Mm-hmm. There was some talk about when the Ku Klux Klan was so mm-hmm. prevalent, making Missouri into a Jim Crow state. But Joseph B. Shannon, who later was a congressman from this district, he was a member of the Missouri legislature, and the history don't show these things. And that's the reason I think the history should be written, because there's so many things that are so important to the Negro that have never been written, mm-hmm. never been shown.
Oh, getting back to World War I briefly, what was your rank when you were mustered out?
I went in as a private first class, and Cuba is a private first class. I stayed right there in headquarters company. I issued rations and kept the books and things like that. But it was one of the finest jobs in the world, because I didn't have to put the front. Mm-hmm. I lived well. I issued the rations, and I went in as a private and crew member.
Thank you very much.
They're not very many spaces in the headquarters company.
Yeah.
Black man, a young Negro.
This is Homer Roberts.
Homer Roberts.
Okay.
Homer Roberts was a very unusual person. For getting together this group of Negroes and having them enlist in the United States Army, which were made up of chauffeurs, post office employees, men who ran on the road, and some hotel men. You take in 1918. There weren't as many opportunities for young Negro men. When you worked in a private family, a lot of them worked in a private family for multimillionaire white people. Before I went to the post office, that's why I worked. I worked for multimillionaire Mrs. E.R. Jones, mm-hmm. 571 Mission Drive, a very cultured and refined white lady. I learned J.D. Williams coming.
What was Lieutenant Roberts' background? What did he do before he got involved?
Homer Roberts was a fairly well-educated young man. I think he attended school at
And he was born and reared in the state of Kansas, and I think he went to one of the colleges in Kansas. But he was a very unusual person. After he came out of the war, he established the Roberts automobile business, sold the Hubmobile. Later on, I was a salesman in the organization. But he was a very unusual individual. And for having gotten together those 25 young Negroes, he was commissioned, either lieutenant or captain, in World War I. And he was in the signal department. And he served in that capacity in the signal corps. In other words, he had young men, when we were marching to the front, they were stringing a line of communication. And when the commanding officer of the outfit asked him what time we're going to be able to have communication back to front, he said, all you got to do is to raise the receiver on your telephone. You have service right now. He was a very unusual person. And he established a business here when he
came out of Kansas City.
Yeah, came out of war. The Roberts, and there's a building here, the Roberts building, on 18th and between 18th and 19th on Vine Street.
That was erected for his business. Mm-hmm. Very interesting. Okay, you said that you went with Bill Knox to the group at Camp Funston. But then there was a colonel that wanted to send you home. What was his name? David B.
David B. Down.
Down. D O W.
Downing. D O W N I N G. Downing.
Okay.
Lieutenant. He was a lieutenant colonel.
Uh huh.
Lieutenant Colonel David B. Downing. He was a doctor out of Detroit, Michigan.
Mm-hmm.
I went to Camp Funston, Kansas, after Homer Roberts had taken this group of 20 or 25 men. Mm-hmm. And one of the young men who was in that group was named Flip Blair. And he wrote me a letter. And in that letter, he told me that he had joined the United States Army, and he was just making up one link of the great chain of men who made up the great army. And he felt it was his duty to enlist and serve his country. And as he was fighting for one of the greatest flags that was ever unfurled in the world, the red, white, and blue. And he thought it was the duty of all young men to join him. Well, after having read that letter and having known Clifford Blair, he lived in Troy, Kansas, and I lived in Highland, Kansas. But we were good friends, been friends all of our life. So there wasn't anything to do me but to go and join the United States Army. Dr. McGill and Mrs. McGill took me to the train, paid my own way up there. I soldiered around there for about a week with that group. And then I think it was in Captain Day's company. He was a doctor out of Nashville or Memphis, Tennessee. He was a captain. He was in accord for me to stay in the company. But Lieutenant Colonel David B. Downing sent me to come to the headquarters company and told me that I was just there taking up space. The government was board and feeding me, and they had no provision for us for me to go on home. Well, I didn't go home. I went to see Colonel Cole. He was a full-fledged colonel. And I talked to Colonel Cole.
How do you spell?
C-O-L-E.
Okay.
Colonel Cole. He told me, and I told him some of them were qualified, he said, the Army needs men of your caliber. And he immediately inducted me into the United States Army. And instead of going home, Lieutenant Colonel David B. Downing, who wanted to send me home, he assigned me to his headquarters company, and I served there through the duration of the war.
Sweeney, if there's anything regards to World War I that you still might recall or want to share with us, maybe we've jogged your memory and you thought of something that you didn't get a chance to say earlier, please feel free to just volunteer it.
Well, I want to say this, that the American white man was very jealous of the Negro. It appears that the Negro was able to pick out some of the most beautiful and most charming and some of the finest French women. That was my experience when I was over there. And I've been in the what do you call it, chapeau, what do you call it? Chateaus.
Chateau, yeah.
And French women are lovely women. They're beautiful. They're charming. They're sweet. They're gracious. everything a man could wish for.
Isn't it true that many men in the 92nd married and stayed in France?
Well, a lot of them did marry, and the girl wanted me to, because she wanted to come over here and with me and marry me, but I didn't know what to bring over here, that's why I didn't bring her. She was very charming.
But do you recall men in your unit
that stayed, that did not return?
Yes. You do. Did you correspond with them?
Or I have not, no.
Have any other communications with them?
I'd like to go back to France sometime.
I was going to ask you if you had ever returned.
I haven't returned, but I'd like to.
I think that would be real fine.
Beautiful trip.
That'd be real fine.
France
well,
is a great city, a great country. Very great. People treat us love.
Mm-hmm.
And the only time that I ever breathed what you call to be liberty and to be a full-fledged citizen was when I put my foot upon the soil. Because there's no discrimination, no difference. I found no difference over there, but that's me not trying to learn the French language.
Very touching to your fellow soldiers.
I don't know. I can't remember any now, but Bob.
I keep pretty busy. I've been a director of the Douglas State Bank. I've been a director of the Twin City Federal Savings Loan. I'm the advisory director of the Twin City Safety Federal Savings Loan Organization of $246 million institution. I'm a commissioner with the Urban Renewal. Just yesterday, a lady whom is the commissioner on the Urban Renewal came to my house and got me and picked me up in a Mercedes and took me out to the Nelson Art Gallery yesterday, and I had lunch out there. Looked at all the fine paintings because I had lived with Mr. Kinsey Beveridge. I had lived with the cow of by Gainsborough. I had lived with Lady Fitzgerald of Hoffman. I had lived with the tambourine girl of Gainsborough. I had lived with the French Hall paintings, one of the finest Guinness collections of West Mississippi River. In Mrs. A.R. Jones's house, she had some of the finest antiques. She had some of the finest paintings. So, and notwithstanding that fact, I am still a friend of the Jones family. At my Alpha party, in other words, at all of my parties, I used to invite Lawrence Jones and his wife to come down to Grosvenor Court. Lawrence Jones has a son, he and his wife at the last Alpha party that was given out to the elderly passengers. We had a kind of a warm-up party at 5028 Sunset Drive, a very good friend of mine. Then we went on to the Alameda Plaza, so I have maintained a friendship with the people for whom I've worked. I guess this is second generation. And sometime I go down and still have breakfast with Lawrence Jones, who's on the 22nd floor in the Commerce Towers, because I learned from Booker Washington's struggles up in slavery, where you make a contact, and it's a good contact, hold on to it tenaciously. So I don't lose my contact. I hold it. Well, in Lumgarden, I wanted to run for county executive. A friend of him told him if he wanted to get elected, it would probably be proper for him to get acquainted with Bob Sweeney. So I have been a very close friend of Mr. Bumgarten, Mr. His secretary, Ms. Carey. On my last birthday, Bumgarten and Bryant, a public relations girl named Miss Roddick, and Miss Terry, his personal secretary, another good friend of mine named Gene Edwards, a friend like Sam Davis. He and me luncheon out to the Steve's in Apple Orchard and made November 14, 1979. Robert L. Sweeney and giving a proclamation, which I have at home on my face. So I still maintain my friends with friendship with people whom I have known. And down to Kansas Star, you've got a man down there named Casey Jones. You've got another fellow man named Fitzsimmons. But I have been very close to the Kansas Star for the past 50 years. Roy Roberts, who used to own that Kansas Star, was a very good friend of mine. And when I retired from the post office, they had a big article of mine, I guess, on the front page, Lennon Laird. Lennon Laird was there then. If you look back in your copy it won't be until like the first 1964. But Lennon Laird wrote a big story about me on Kansas Star. And I've always maintained a good connection with Kansas Star for the past 50 years.
Last but not least, tell them what good AMB church man you are.
Well.
Where you go to church?
Well, I'm a member of our chapel church. And I think it's very necessary for persons who have a church on. I'm a trustee in my church. And I try to be careful about church because I think the church has to get along just like a person's home does. And I started out giving my church $40 a month, but every time I got a raise in my retirement, I raised my ante to the church. So I raised my ante to my church where I give my church at minimum $100 a month. That's one of the first checks that I write, because I found out that a lot of people have. I have found this to be true, as far as I'm concerned. I think if you contribute to your church, I think other things, when you contribute to them, you don't look for something back, but things just come to you automatically. I found it to be true in my life.
I'm 89 years old.
I can shoot my age.
Incredible.
And I've been playing golf over 60 years. And the colored people didn't have any place to play in Kansas City. Another friend of mine, we both were chauffeurs outside. We'd get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, play country club this morning, Indian Hills the next morning, and play until the greenkeepers would come out and run us off. See? And that's where we got our golf experience. So,
one thing I think you haven't told about when you worked with Mrs. Brown, that's how I got into the private family, because Bill Knox gave me a job.
Oh, yes. I was working for this rich couple that had a 10,000-acre. They had a daughter, and so she loaned me a chauffeur. She said, "Bill, I want you to give me a good boy." Well, Robert here was selling real estate down on 18th Street. I said, "Bob, I got a job for you." "What is it?" I says, "Mrs. Brown's daughter wants a chauffeur. I'd like to have it." So I go out and tell Mrs. Jones that I got a chauffeur. She says, "All right, just take me down." I took it down to Bob's office. I get out and go in. I said, "Robert, Miss Jones out here, she wants to talk to you. Tell her to come in my office. Tell her to come in my office." So I went out and said, "Miss Jones, he'll see you now." So she goes in. Bob whirls around in his chair, you know, and his pants behind him. She says, "Hello, Robert. William's been telling me about you. I need a chauffeur. Would you like to have a job?" Her and Bob gets together, and Bob takes the job. So that's how Bob got into private family. Out south, he was came out and took the job as chauffeur. So we, from old times in France and everything, we got back together, and we had Bob bought an old jalopy, and Mr. Jones wouldn't allow him to keep it on the place, so he parked it over on a lot, 2 or 3 blocks away. That was our transportation to town every night. Bob's saying was, "Yellow money, yellow women, and a jalopy, and we got it made." So we had a time of our life.